Hi guys, welcome to another episode of How She DJs. I go by the name of Adila. I am your favorite alternative slash house DJ. Let's go. How and when I started DJing, so I was seeing a guy. and his best friend was a DJ, and we used to go to like all of his gigs. And you know, I've always had a passion for music since I was young, guys. I've always loved music. And I just knew that, you know, because I was always that girl in the club who just heard the song before the DJ fully mixed it in. And then when I realized that DJing was how people get that done, I was like, no, shoot, I need to be a DJ. And at the time, my biggest influences were probably Keitra Nada, still today, Keitra. You know, the thing with critics, the thing about critics is all they can do is talk about your shit. Am I allowed to cuss? All they can do is talk about like what you're doing or what you're not doing. And I've realized like the biggest thing that you can do is to do you. I mean, obviously, like you're never too big to grow and you're always growing, you're always improving. And at the end of the day, all you can do is show out. And then eventually, I'm telling you, that's how you just like calm the naysayers down. So I really haven't been doing much but being myself and doing me. I think the very most important lesson that I've learned now that my DJing is a bit more professional is we really need to understand the business, guys, of music. We really definitely need to understand the business of music. But when I was still starting out, I'd say that the one thing I really had to learn and the hard way was patience. Because when you start DJing, you really feel like you're the best DJ, or actually you can rock with the best of the best DJs. And you actually can't, guys. You need to pay your dues, you need to learn, you need to struggle just a bit. And I'm not like romanticizing struggle, I'm just saying you really need to grow through what you go through. Honestly, when it comes to preparing my DJ sets, I'm the worst, guys. I'm honestly the worst. So I play alternative. With regards to alternative, I play future beats, I play house. And when you play house, you really can't prepare a set. I mean, you can have an idea of what it is that you want to play, but how many other house DJs are on the lineup? So I really just arrive and I rock, guys. I base it on, you know, who's played what, how's the crowd doing, how's the crowd feeling, and then that just guides me. So I wouldn't say I necessarily prepare, I'm a freestyler. I've realized that, you know, when it comes to engaging with the crowd, it goes beyond your set. These days, we're living in a very digital era. Like, what's your social media presence like when people commend you on your set? Because usually 9 out of 10, and I don't know why people do this, 9 out of 10 people would rather tweet you and say, amazing set, as opposed to physically coming to you. So I realized that, like, the first part of it is engaging with whoever's following you on social media. That's very important. Also, just like, you know, set yourself up in a way that makes you approachable in real life on social media, and that's honestly just how I deal with that. I'd definitely still be a DJ. I think knowing what I know now, and this is something that we've actually had lengthy debates about. I remember sitting down with Gogo, who's also, you know, I remember sitting down with Gogo and her manager Kobe, and I remember telling them, I was like, guys, I really just want to be a chill hand who DJs when things are nice. And she was telling me that, you know, the business of DJing is in networking. I really wish I had prioritized networking, meeting people, letting people meet me, and getting my name out there in a way where I'm meeting the relevant stakeholders. And by stakeholders, I mean your promoters, your club managers, the people who actually allow for us as DJs to be DJs, you know, because you can be a DJ, but you're only as good as the people booking you. And that's something I should have learned, because I really thought that my talent would get me where I wanted to go. But like, guys, it goes beyond talent. You know, you can work hard, but you also need to network just as hard. I think the biggest mistake I've noticed, and this is something I can speak about because I went through it as well, you don't need to adjust yourself or your sound to fit a certain criteria or to fit what you think people expect you as a female in the industry to look like. I mean, how many women are there in entertainment? I'm not even talking about DJing now. How many women are there in entertainment? We can't all look the same, because then what makes you stand out, you know? We can't all sound the same, because what makes you stand out then? And at the end of the day, you need to stay true to yourself, because being yourself is actually what gets you booked. My advice to upcoming females is stay true to yourself. Know what you want out of the industry, because it's very easy for people to lie to you and shy you, like, no, babes. You must know what it is that you want out of your career and have a clear set path that you're willing to embark on. My top five, guys, this is such a difficult question. My top five favorite tracks currently, it's such a difficult question. It's such a, you know, as a DJ, guys, you dig through music. So I'm like, I'm experiencing new tracks on a daily basis. But currently, my favorite tracks, there is one by Kayla Maestro. It's called Trust. There's another one by Kay Chinada that I'm really feeling now, which is an old one. Actually, it's called Killer Cats. Your five. I think the other three, this is not so much alternative, but it is kind of alternative house. I'm really feeling Are You Jazz by Beats by Hand. And then I'm also really feeling the China Chameleon remix of the same song. And as a whole, I know it's not a track per se, but as a whole, I'm really, really, really vibing with Dawson right now. He's a DJ slash producer, amazing guy.